وعلى بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين الهاديين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا. قال الله العلي العظيم في كتابه الكريم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إنما يريد الله ليذهب عنكم الرجس أهل البيت ويطهركم تطهيرا. صدق الله العلي العظيم. This ayah is mentioned in Surah Al-Ahzab, ayah 33, and is called ayah al-tathhir, the verse of purification. Every surah, or most of the surahs in the Quran, or verses in the Quran, they have what we call sabab al-nuzul. Sabab al-nuzul means the cause of revelation. Why the surah was revealed or the verse was revealed. This ayah also has what we call sabab al-nuzul, the reason of revelation. For us to understand this ayah about Ahlul Bayt alayhimu salam, it is very important to know the reason why this ayah was revealed. And tonight, as we are commemorating the death of Zahra alayhi salam, it is very important to know this ayah, because this ayah is mainly about Zahra alayhi salam. And this is not from one school of thought nor the other. No, this is from the Muslims across the board. And I'm talking about Sunni or Shia school of thought. But before I start, let me start from the Sunni school of thought. What do they say about this sabab al-nuzul, the reason of this ayah was revealed upon the Prophet? One of the scholars, which is known in the Sunni Muslim school of thought, is one of the scholars called Al-Hakim al-Nisaburi. Al-Hakim al-Nisaburi is one of the Greek scholars. And he is an author of a book called Shawahid al-Tanzil. In that book, this great scholar mentioned what we call sabab al-nuzul for this ayah, the reason why this ayah was revealed. And what did he say? An amazing, this scholar, he mentioned two hadith from the wives of the Prophet. One is Salama and the other one is Aisha. The first hadith he mentioned from Salama, he said the ayah was revealed because he gave the short version of what we call hadith al-tisa. The version was this, that Salama said, one day I was in the house with Rasulullah. Then Rasulullah came in and he asked Zahra alayhi salam to bring a blanket. Zahra brought the blanket and then he told, this from Salama, and the Prophet told Zahra, Ya Zahra, call me your husband and your two sons, Al-Hasan and Hussein. Zahra went and called them. When they all came, Rasulullah was there, and Zahra also came, and then and also Al-Hasan and Hussein and Imam Ali. Then the Prophet took the blanket and then covered all of them. And he said, this is from Al-Hakim al-Nisaburi, a Sunni scholar. He said, after he covered them, then he said, Allahumma ha'ula'i ahlu bayti. Ya Allah, these people, which are under the blanket, they are my progeny. Wahammati. Hammam is what? Those who are my protectors, those who protect me. Wahassati. And they are my special ones. Allahumma, oh Allah. Allah forgive them. Wa adhib anhum al-rijs. And keep the abomination from them. wa tahirhum tathir. And purify them. And then Allah sent Jibril with this ayah. Innama yuridu Allah liyudhiba ankum ar-rijs ahlal bayt wa tahirakum. He said that is the reason of the ayah was revealed. That's one. From whom? From Umm Salam. The next one from Aisha, also from Sawahib al-Tanzil. He said, after the battle of Jamal, one of the companions came to Aisha. And he asked him, Ya Aisha, what is your opinion about Ali? And she said, what can I say about him when I know he is the most beloved man to the Prophet? So Aisha radiallahu anha, she's the one singing. Alright? Then what happened? And then after that, she added, she said, wa also, Imam Ali, zawjatu ahabbu an-nas ila rasulina. The husband of the most beloved woman to the Prophet, which is Zahra alayhi salam. And then she added, she said, I was in the house one day when Rasulullah came and he told Zahra alayhi salam to bring him a blanket. Then the Zahra brought the blanket and he covered them, Al-Hassan and Hussein and Imam Ali, including himself. Then Aisha, here there is a little different from this than from the first one. Then Aisha said, after the Prophet covered them, then she came forward. So, Ya Rasulullah, can I come under the blanket too? And then the Prophet says, La, you cannot come in. It's Aisha saying. The Prophet told her, no, you cannot come in. Walakin innaki ala khair. But you're a good woman. But you're not part of my limit. Right? Then she said, I was standing there and I heard Rasulullah said, Allahumma ha'ulai ahlu bayt. These are my progeny. And then he says, fadhib anhum ar-rijs wa tahhirhum tathira. And Allah sent Jibril with the ayah, tell Rasulullah, innama yuridu Allah liyudhiba ankum ar-rijs ahlal bayt wa yutahhirakum tathira. That is another hadith from where? From Shawahid al-Tanzil, from the Sunni school of thought about this ayah. But there is another version from the Shia school of thought, Ahlul Bayt school of thought, about this verse. And that is what I want us to learn tonight as we're learning and talking about Zahra, because there is more detailed information about this ayah and the post of revelation from Ahlul Bayt school of thought. Now, the first thing about this hadith from Ahlul Bayt school of thought is that the narrator of this hadith is one of the reliable companions, and it's called Jabir. Jabir alayhi salam was one of the great companions of Rasulullah. And he lived very long life. He lived life along with the Prophet. After the Prophet, he lived through the companions until the time of Ali, the time of Hussein, Hassan and Hussein, and the time of Imam Zayn al-Abidin, he was alive. He got to see all of them. And the Prophet told him before this, the day he asked the Prophet a question, and the Prophet answered him. And what was the question? Jabir asked the Prophet a question, Ya Rasulullah, when the ayah, another ayah was revealed, and he was not sure about the ayah. What was the ayah? He said, Allah sent the ayah to the Prophet, where he says, Atiyu Allah wa atiyu Rasul wa ulul amri minkum. Allah said, obey Allah and the Prophet and the leaders of your affairs. Jabir said, he went to the Prophet, Ya Rasulullah, the ayah is not clear to me. The first one, atiyu Allah, obey Allah. He said, I know Allah. Atiyu Rasul, obey you, I know. But the third part is not clear to me. Who are the leaders of my affairs that Allah want me to follow? Him, Allah, and the Prophet, and them. Who are those? Then the Prophet said to him, Ya Jabir, and this is mentioned in Musnad of Imam Hanbal, one of the four school of thought. In his book, he mentioned this hadith, where then the Prophet told Jabir, Ya Jabir, those leaders of your affairs that Allah wants you to obey them, they are a'immatul muslimin. Allahu Akbar. The imams of Muslims. Now listen carefully. All right? Now here the Prophet didn't say, A'immatu Shia. No, for that's why we say Ahlul Bayt, they are not for one group or the other. Ahlul Bayt, they are Imams of the entire humanity. Because Imamit, it's not for one group and not the other. Because when you go to the Quran, when Allah wanted to make Ibrahim Imam, Allah told him, Inni ja'iluka lin-nasi Imam. Ya Ibrahim, your leadership is not for those who believe in you. And those who didn't believe, you're not Imam. No, you are Imam for all humanity. The position of Imamate is for all humanity, even not just humanity. Even the jinn also are included. And that is why, in ziyarah of our 12th Imam, As-salamu alayka ya Imam al-insi wal-jan. Imam of humans and jinn as well. Right? So when Jabir asked the Prophet, then the Prophet told him, Hum a'immatul muslimin. And then he started telling them one by one. I said, awwaluhum, the first Imam is Ali ibn Abi Talib. Say the second one is Imam Al-Hasan ibn Ali alayhi salam. The third one, Al-Husayn ibn Ali alayhi salam. Then he said, the next one, Ali ibn Al-Husayn alayhi salam. The next one, he says, Allahu Akbar, Muhammad ibn Ali Al-Baqir. And the Prophet paused right there. From Imam, didn't say anything. Then Hassan didn't say anything. Hussein didn't say anything. Imam Zayd al-Abid didn't make any comment. Until he got Imam Baqir, then he said to him, Ya Jabir wa satudriku. He said, you will live longer to meet him. Wa idha adraktahu. Allahu Akbar. When you meet him, he said, I have a message for you. To him, Imam Baqir. What is it? I said, فَإِذَا أَدْرَكْتَهُ فَأَبْلِغْهُ مِنِّي السَّلَامِ. Allah. I said, send my salam to him. وَقُلْ and tell him, وَهَذَا سَلَامُ مِنْ جَدِّكَ رَسُولِهِ. Allah. The Prophet is telling him, to tell him, to send the salam to him, and say to Imam Baqir, Ya Baqir, this salam is not from me, it's from your grandfather Rasulullah. Right? And Jabir did live long. And he saw Imam Baqir. But there were some changes. What was the changes? By the time Imam Al-Jabir came to see Imam Baqir, he was very old. And he was blind. He came to see Imam Zayn al-Abidin. And he heard a voice, like a young child in the house. Then he asked Imam Zayn al-Abidin, whose voice am I hearing? Then Imam said, it's my son. What is his name? Jabir asked. Then the Imam Zayn al-Abidin says, his name is Muhammad. I said, please let him come closer to me. Because he cannot see to go to him. He said, can he come closer? Then Imam called Imam Baqir. Imam Baqir came. Then he hugged him. And he kissed him. And he said to him, Hada salamu min jaddika rasulika. This salam that I'm giving you is not from me. I said, this is a special salam from whom? From your grandfather told me to tell you. Allahu Akbar. You know, the beautiful part is this. After he delivered the message, Imam Baqir said to him, Jazakallahu anna ahl al-bayt khayra. May Allah reward you for giving, for taking care of this salam. You kept it all these years and you delivered it to me from my grandfather. I said, Jazakallahu anna khayra wa razakakallah. Du'a from Imam Baqir to him. I said, and may Allah grant you the shafa'ah of my grandfather on the day that people will need the shafa'ah. Allah back, Jabir was sitting and all you can see is tears on his cheek. You know this dua is a gold, it's better than gold. There's nothing you can compare for this kind of dua, right? Now this Jabir is the one that narrated the narration from Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam. And from whom? From Zahra alayhi salam. And dua, and when you go to Fatih al-Jinan, the detail is there. But I just want to give you some key points so we can learn something tonight. From that hadith al-Qisa, and then we get to know the importance of Zahra. The first point is, Jabir said, and Jabir ibn Abdullah al-Ansari. His last name is Ansari. Al-Ansari fi muqabil al-Muhajir. Because among the companions, there are two names. Some are called Ansari. Ansari are the people of Medina. And Muhajir are those who travel, from Mecca to Medina. Ansari means is from people of Medina. Then he said, and Fatima, he heard and quoted from Zahra alayhi salam, directly. Annaha qalat, that Zahra said to him, dakhala alayya abi Rasulullah. Allahu Akbar. That my father, Zahra alayhi salam, she said to Jabir, dakhala abi. My father came to my house. Fi ba'd al-ayyam, in one of the days, faqal, and he said to me, assalamu alayki ya father. Allahu Akbar. The first lesson we're going to learn from Hadith al-Qisa tonight from Zahra, right? And all of this is happening where? In the house of Zahra, right? The first thing the Prophet said to him, to her, is assalamu alayki ya father. The first lesson, brothers, is to learn to know the importance of Islamic greetings. In other languages, we might have greetings. We said, hi, what's up, and all kind of greetings. That's what we said when we see each other. But you know what? In Islam, there is special greetings. And that greeting comes from Allah. And that greetings can never be found anywhere and can never be compared with anything. And that is the word, assalamu alaykum. Allahu Akbar. Brothers, wallah, learn to know the importance of this dua. Because this greetings is not like any other greeting. This is kalimatul dua. Do not the importance of this salam, right? Allah tells you and I in the Quran, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu la tadkhulu buyutan hatta tusallimu ala ahliha. Never enter a house unless you say salam first. That's the ruling Islam. I come to your house. Islam says don't enter the house until you say salam, right? فَإِن قِيلَ لَكُمْ أَرْجِعُوا. That's the, one of the adab of visiting. Quran said, if you are to be told, go back. Alright? It's a farjah. Don't force yourself to enter. No, go back. But if you are invited to the house and you said salam, first you enter, he says salam. That is the importance of Islamic teachings. Not only that, this salam, brothers and sisters, in our Islam, in our faith, there's a, when a person is praying, a person is doing salam, talking to Allah, Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim, then a person passed by and says, Salamu Alaikum. You know what Allah said about that? In fact, Allah says, stop talking to me and respond to that salam. It's wajib. In the middle of salah, you're reading Fatiha or Surah, somebody says, Salamu Alaikum, Allah says, stop and respond to the salam, because that salam is so important that you cannot ignore, even during the time you're talking to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is the importance of salam. Number two, another one, brothers, when we go to visit our imams, every imam that you go, from the Prophet to the 12th imam, right? Read the ziyarah. What do you say? Assalamu alayka ya Rasulullah. You go to Imam Ali. Assalamu alayka ya Amir al-Mu'mineen. You go to Zahra, assalamu alayki ya Fatima. Imam Hassan, every imam, when you go to say salute them, the word that you use is assalamu alayka. If there were to be a best greeting than this, you would have used it. But there is nothing better than the word assalamu. Not only that, brothers, in Islam they say when you enter your own house, there's nobody in the house, right? Islam says, still say salam before you enter, and Allah will put the angels to respond to your salam. That is the importance of salam. Not only that, brothers, now in Islam, right, they said when you say salam first, right, you have how many reward? 99 reward for just starting the salam. And the person, now look, amazing. Saying salam is mustahab, right? But the one who initiated, Islam said they have 99 reward. Now responding to the salam is wajib. If you don't, you get the punishment. You get the saying for not saying it, but you still get one reward in return. And that is why one of the adab of the Prophet, no person ever said salam before the Prophet. That's one of the akhlaq of the Prophet. Anytime there is any meeting, any person sees the Prophet was the first one to start salam. Not only that, Yawm al-Qiyamah, if we are to meet in the heaven, you know what greeting we're going to say? And Allah said in the Quran, وَتَحِيَّتُهُمْ فِيهَا salam. Our greetings of mu'mineen in the heaven is salam alaikum. That's the importance of salam. Now, from hadith perspective, you know, the Prophet told one of the companions, he said, لَا تَدْخُلُ الْجَنَّةَ حَتَّى تَحَابُ. You can never go to heaven unless you love each other. You love good for yourself, you love for others too. You want good for yourself, you have to want for others as well. That's the first thing. Whatever good I want for myself, I have to want for others as well. That's the first rule to go to heaven. وَلَن تَحَابُوا حَتَّى تُسَلِّمُوا عَلَى بَعْضِكُمْ بَعْضٍ. Then the Prophet says, what can you do to bring that kindness among yourself? The Prophet said, the first and the most important thing is to spread salam among yourself. That is the importance of salam. So the Prophet, when he came to the house of Zahra, the first thing he says, As-salamu alayki ya Prophet. That's the lesson number one. Then the Prophet says, wa alayka salam. The Prophet says, wa alayka salam, ya Abat. Then the Prophet says, ya Fatima, inni ash'uru fi badani du'fa. Ya Zahra, I feel some weaknesses in my body. Allahu Akbar. Now listen careful, the word of the Prophet, one by one. The Prophet says, ya Zahra, I feel weakness. Where? In body. Not in my mind or ruh or akal. The akal of the Prophet doesn't become weak. The ruh of the Prophet doesn't become weak. The nafs of the Prophet doesn't become weak. Because the nafs and the akal and the ruh is protected by Allah. And the body is like any normal body. It can go through changes. And that's why the Prophet, when he mentioned, he said, Ash'ur fi badani. My body is in weakness. But there is more important lesson here. Ya Rasulullah, if your body is feeling weak, if you feel weakness, shouldn't you go to the masjid of the Prophet? Your masjid? Why the house of Zahra? There is a message there. What's the message? That you people, wherever you have an issue or problem, the house you're supposed to go is the house of Zahra and Ahlul Bayt alayhi wasallam. Because one ayah in the Quran, Allah tells us, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنًا. Because whatever the Prophet does is a role model for us. When the Prophet was weak, he goes to the house of Zahra to tell us that that is where we're supposed to go whenever we have an issue. Then he says, Ya Zahra, Ya Fatima, itini bil kisa'i al-yaman. Bring me a blanket made from Yemen. Faghattini bih, and cover me with it. Allahu Akbar. Now why this? Why is blanket? Ya Rasulullah, why blanket? Here, our Mufassirin, they say, the wisdom is this. The Prophet wants to make sure that the individuals that will be under that blanket will never be mixed with the other individuals who are not part of Ahlul Bayt. So to protect and let the Ummah to know who are his Ahlul Bayt, he has to cover them so people know who are the exact acting baby. That's why I asked for the blanket. Zahra brought the blanket and she covers the prophet. He said, Fagatayituhu. Then I cover the prophet. Is that all? No. Then Zahra is now speaking what she saw. She said, Fasirtu anzur ilay. Then I stop watching at the face of the prophet. Look at the miracle of the prophet and Zahra both. Now, you and I, when you cover something with blanket, can you see it after that? Blanket is a thing. You cover something, you can't see it, right? Zahra said, after I cover the prophet with that blanket, I still can see the nur of the prophet through that blanket, and it's shining like the full moon. That is the lesson. That is to tell us about the nur of the prophet. Nothing can cover the nur of the prophet. That is, the Zahra said, فَسِرْتُ أَنْدُرْ إِلَيْكَ فَإِذَا وَجْهُ This face, يَتَلَأْلَى It's shining. كَأَنَّهُ الْبَتَرْ It's like a full moon. فِي لَيْلَةِ تَمَامِهِ وَكَمَالِ فَمَا أَنْ كَانَتْ إِلَّا سَعْرٍ Not too long. فَإِذَا بِوَلَدْيَا حَسْنِ Then Imam Hassan walks in. What does he say? The same like Prophet. As-salamu alayki ya Umar. Peace be upon you, my Lord. Another lesson for all of us as children. You see, Imam al-Hassan alayhi salam as his Imam. But he still doesn't call his mother by the name. He calls her, Ya Ummah, my mother. Allahu Akbar. You know, this is a lesson for all of us. That we should not call our parents by their names. Islam doesn't allow us to do that. In one of the hadith, they said, when a child calls his father or his mother by their name, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will test him or her with poverty. How will that happen? They say, يَرْفَعُ اللَّهُ الْبَرَكَةَ مِنْ عُمْرِهِ Just to call my father or my mother by their real name, Allah takes the blessing from their life, from their child life. Because I call my father with their name. I should not. A child was to call the father and the mother by Ya Abba, my father or a mother. And that is to show a respect. Because in Islam, after Allah and the Prophet and Ahlul Bayt, the most important people is your parents. Imam Hassan when he came, he said, As-salamu alayki ya Ummah. And Zahra responded, Wa alayka salam ya walid. Allahu Akbar. This is, see, the first one is a lesson for the children. Now the next one is the lesson for the parents. Because Hadith al-Kisa is about family. Zahra alayhi salam, when is her son told the As-salamu alayka ya Ummah, now Fatima when she responded, she said, Wa alayka salam, and peace be upon you, ya waladi, my son. Allahu Akbar. You know, a parents, when we talk to our children, we have to put some kind of love in it. You know why? Because those kind of words, it softens the heart of a child. Zahra alayhi salam, she said, Wa alayka salam, ya what? My son. She ascribed Hassan to herself, my son. And that is tough then. Wa thamarata fu'adi. And the fruit of my heart.
MashaAllah.
Allah. See, when a child hears those kind of words from the mother, it creates a bond between that child and the mother. And you know what it teaches us? A mother is the one who initiates the relationship between a son or a daughter and the mom. It starts from the parent. The way I treat my son, the way I talk to my son, is the way that my son will come closer to us. And it's very important when we want to call our children, pick the loving names and words. Because sometimes some parents,
A'udhu billah. When we talk to our children like they are our enemies, we call them names. That is not a good child. It's not a good parenting to do.
Zahra alayhi salam, she tells us, a mother is supposed to be what? Choosing beautiful name when we call our children.
Waladi wa thamarat fu'ad. Then after that, Imam al-Hassan said to her, Ya Ummah,
twice, my mother,
inni ashum ra'iha, I can smell a fragrance like my grandfather. You know all the prophets, from Adam up to Prophet Muhammad, they all have a special smell from Allah.
Special gift from Allah to the Prophet. And so as our Imams, every Imam has a special smell from heaven.
Now somebody might ask, where is that? I'll tell you from the Quran, from Surah Yusuf.
Right? Yusuf alayhi salam, when he heard his father was blind, and he took his shirt and he gave to his brothers, he said, my brothers, take this shirt when you get home. He said, drop it in front of my father and he will get his eyes back.
The moment the children, the brothers, the children of Yaqub entered the house,
Yaqub was in the house, in the room. He said, inni la ajidu riha Yusuf.
He hasn't seen them yet, right?
Inside the house, inside the room. He said, I can smell
the fragrance of Yusuf. Is Yusuf here? Yusuf is not there. But just from the shirt, he could smell.
And amazing. Quran didn't use the word smell, by the way. Quran used the word ajidu, which is in Arabic, you call it anni ashum. Asham in Arabic means smell through the nose. But Yaqub didn't say inni ashum, he said la ajidu.
In tafsir, they say la ajidu means what? Means I can feel and sense and smell through my five senses the smell of Yusuf.
Meaning the word ajidu is more powerful. Because ashum means just from the nose. But ajidu means every part of me feel the existence and presence of Yusuf.
That is to tell us every prophet has a smell. And our prophet is the same. Imam Hassan, when he came, he said, that inni ashumu, I smell a fragrance. Ka'annaha ra'ihatu jaddi. Smell like my grandfather, Rasulullah.
Then Zahra alayhi salam says, na'am.
Ha'huwa tahta al-kisra. Rasulullah is under the blanket.
Fadana al-Hassan.
Then Imam Hassan went front to the blanket.
Then he said, As-salamu alayka ya jadda.
He said, peace be upon you, oh my grandfather. Allahu Akbar. Now listen to the answer of the Prophet.
Wa alayka salam
ya waladi. The same like Zahra. And peace be upon you, my son.
Is that all? No, no, no. And then what happened? He said, وَيَا صَاحِبَ حَوْضِي.
See, he said, my son, and he add a title for Imam Hassan. And every one of Ahlul Bayt who comes,
the Prophet gives them the title. The title of Hassan is what? صَاحِبَ حَوْضِي, meaning the owner and the one, the caretaker of my pond yawmul qiyamah. Because the Prophet will be given a kawthar, a pond, and the one who will be giving people to drink from it is Imam al-Hassan. Oh.
So the Prophet gave him that title.
وَيَا صَاحِبَ حَوْضِي. And then he said to him, to his father, he says, أَتَأَذَنُنِي أَنْ أَدْخُلْ مَعَكَ.
Do I have your permission to come under the blanket? Then the Prophet said, no, كَنْ أَذَيْتُ لَكَ. Come in. Then Imam Hassan, فَدَخَلَ الْحَسَنْ. He entered.
فَمَا كَانَ إِلَّا سَاعَةً. Not too long. فَإِذَا بِوَلَدِيَ الْحُسَيْنِ
كَدْ أَكْبَلْ. Allahu Akbar. Now look at the miracle.
The Prophet came. Then later on, Al-Hassan came.
Now, how did they get to know? You think they texted each other?
Rasulullah was under the blanket and he sent a text or email. Ya Hassan, where are you?
Allah has a mission to accomplish here.
And what's that? What is it? Allah wants to show something. So Allah made the Prophet to come, and then after that, Imam Hassan came. And amazing, why Hassan first? Why not Hussein first? Why not Imam Ali first and then Hassan? No, Allah has something to show. You know what is it? Allahu Akbar. First they were children and then the father later. You know what that means? Always parents should put children first. And finally, a parent, they always should put the children first. And that is the teaching of Quran. You go to the Quran in Ayat al-Mubahala, when Allah was telling the Prophet, when he was to debate with the Christians, Allah told the Prophet, Ya Rasulallah, tell the Christians to bring three individuals. Right? Yeah. Now, three individuals. Who's the first one? فَقُلْ تَعَالَوْ نَدْعُوا أَبْنَاءَنَا, the children first. Then whom? وَنِسَاءَنَا, then the ladies. وَأَنفُسَنَا, then ourselves. So children should always be put first in the teaching of Islam. The Prophet in his gatherings, anytime the Prophet wants to give something in his gatherings, the Prophet always starts with the children, which is against our teachings today. Today, older and then children last. In Islamic adab, always the children should be given the preference. And the Hadith al-Kisab does the same thing. Al-Hassan came, and then Hussein came. When Imam Hussein came, the same thing like Hassan, As-salamu alayki ya Umam. Peace be upon you, my man. Then Imam Zahra alayhi salatu responded, the same thing. Wa alayka salam ya waladi wa ya qurrata ayn. Allahu Akbar. Now look, in Hadith al-Kisa, the words are different, but the same meaning. Thamarat fu'adi, qurrata ayni, they are two different words, but they mean the same. Zahra alayhi salam, the same thing she said to Hassan, she used the same thing for Hassan, for Hussein alayhi salam. Which is another lesson for the parent, that a parent should not discriminate among your children. Because one of the problems we create in our family, it comes from the parents. Sometimes we see a children grow up and they hate each other. You know who's the cause? The parents. If a father or a mother in the family, I started to show my love for this child more than this, then what happened? Then with that, I create animosity among my children. And that is why Ya'qub alayhi salam, his children hate each other because of that. Even though it wasn't haram for Ya'qub, it's okay in Islam, but Islam wants to tell you that be ready for problems in your family. It's okay in Islam. If I have two children, one of them is more obedient than the other, it's okay to show my affection to the one who lives in the world. It's fine. But Islam says be careful. But because that showing affection to one more than the other, it creates animosity. And that is why Yusuf, his brothers, they hated him so much. And they wanted to kill him. And Zahra alayhi salam, she was everywhere that she tell Hassan, she tried to tell the same thing to Hussein. Wa alayka salam, ya waladi, wa ya qurrata ayni, wa ya thamarat fuadi. It's the different words, but the same meaning. And then he said, ya umma inni ashum. The same thing like Hassan. I smell fragrance. Ka annaha ra'ihatu jaddi. Rasulullah. Then Zahra alayhi salam said, ha huwa ma'a. Akhi is under a blanket with your brother. Imam al-Hussein, come closer. Now listen carefully. Hadith al-Kisa is amazing. It's full of lessons. Now Imam al-Hassan, when he came, he said, As-salamu alayka ya jadda. That's what he said. But Hussein, when he came, his salam is different. Allahu Akbar. What was his salam? As-salamu alayka ya jadda. As-salamu alayka ya man ikhtarahu Allah. He has something to add more than Imam Hassan. What was it? Peace be upon you, my grandfather. Peace be upon you, the chosen one. That's what he said to the Prophet. Now, There is no time to say, why would he say different than Imam Hassan? That is different. But now listen to the answer of the Prophet. The Prophet, when he responded to salam, he said, wa alayka salam, peace be upon you, ya waladi, the same like Imam Hassan, wa ya shafi'a ummati. Now the title of Imam Hussein, Shafi' Ummati. Hassan, Sahib Hawdi, right? Now Imam Hussein alayhi salam, one of his titles is the one who will provide the intercession for the Ummah of Prophet Muhammad.
Allah.
And that is why in Ziyarat Ashura, when you read Ziyarat Ashura, when we go to the sajda, we say, Allahu Akbar. Warzukni shafa'at al-Husayn yawm al-wurud. وثبت لي قدم صدق عندك مع الحسين الله عليه السلام. When one of the requests in the sajda, رزقني شفاعة الحسين. Because Imam Hussein is talking to الشفيع, the one who provides the شفاعة in decision. That's why when you ask, if you want شفاعة, ask Imam Hussein عليه السلام. That's one of his titles. Then Imam Hussein asked the Prophet, "Al ta'adhani? Can I have permission to come and leave?" Then the Prophet said, "No, come and leave. I gave you permission to come." Then he goes and leave. Then the third one comes in. فَمَا كَانَ إِلَّا سَاعَةً فَإِذَا بِأَبِي الْحَسَنِ. Now Imam Ali comes in. Allahu Akbar. Now the children, Al-Hassan and Hussein are under. Now it's the turn for the father. Imam Ali comes in. And what does he say? He said, "Assalamu alayki ya bint Rasulillah." Allahu Akbar. One of the nurses, this is between the husband and wife, family, right? Imam Ali teaches us that a husband should learn to have beautiful words to call his wife. Her name is Fatima. Her name is Zahra. But when he comes home, he doesn't say, "Assalamu alayki ya Fatima." No. Ya assalamu alayhi ya bint Rasulillah. He gives her a title, the daughter of the Prophet. Then Zahra also responded, wa alayka salam. What does he say? What does he call? What does she call her husband? Ya Ali? No. Wa alayka salam. Ya Abul Hassan. Oh, the father of Hassan. Because you know, in Islam, among the Arabs, there are three different names. One is called al-ism, one is called al-laqab, and one is called al-kunya. Al-ism is the given name, maiden name, that a person chooses for his children. It's called al-ism. Al-laqab is called a nickname a person chooses for himself. Al-kunya is a name given to a person because of the child that Allah has given him. And you know, out of these three names, al-ism, Al-Kunya, Al-Laqab, if you want to respect an Arab, the best name to call him is the father of someone. Not his mid-name. No. If you call him Muhammad or Ali, that's a little disrespect. If you want to respect the person more, you say, Ya Abul Hassan, the father of Hassan, then you are giving the person the highest respect. Zahra alayhi salam, she doesn't say to her husband, wa alayka salam ya Ali. That's his name, right? No, she said, wa alayka salam ya Abul Hassan. To give her husband, meaning a husband and wife have to have respect for each other. And especially in front of their children. Now, Al-Hassan and Hussein, they're under the blanket. They're listening how the father and the mother are now communicating with each other. Right? Because a father and a mother, they have to give the perfect example in front of the children at least. When the way you talk to your husband, the way you talk to your wife, it should be very respectful way. So the children listen and they see and they learn from it. Imam Hassan and Hussein, they are under the blanket, they're listening to their parents. How do you communicate to each other? Then Imam Ali also say the same. Inni ashum, I can smell fragrance. Ka'annaha ra'ihatu akhi. Like my brother, Rasulullah. Then Zahra says that.
هو مع ولديك تحت.
Your brother, the Rasulullah is under the blanket with your two sons, right? فدنا علي فنادى فدنا أبو الحسن.
Imam Ali came closer. السلام عليك يا رسول الله.
الله أكبر. Now that is all what he said. السلام عليك يا رسول الله. Now listen to the answer of the Prophet. For Ali was different than Hassan and Hussein. He said, وعليك السلام يا أخي ووصي وخليفتي. الله أكبر.
وصاحب لوائي.
All this for Ali. The title of Hassan was one. Title of Hussein, one. Title of Imam Ali, no, not one, not two, not three, four titles. Akhi, my brother. Wa wasiyyi, my successor. Wa
sahib liwa'i, and the carrier of my band.
This is all for Ali alayhi salam. You know what? What's one lesson here to learn, brothers and sisters? You know, all the Imams, they're all Imams and the leaders. But all of them are not like Ali. Imam Ali alayhi salam is higher than all of them. And the Prophet in one of the hadith, he says, Al-Hasan wal-Husayn imaman in qama aw qa'ada wa abuhuma khayrun minhu. Al-Hasan and Husayn? Said, Al-Hasan and Husayn, they are Imams, whether they are standing or sitting, but their father Ali is better than both of them. Now, how is he better? He has four titles, twice of them, the children. He said, وَيَا أَخِي وَيَا وَصِيِّ وَخَلِيفَتِي وَصَاحِبَ لِوَانِ. Then he asked, أَتَأَذَنُ لِي, do you have your permission to come and get it? قَالَ قَدْ أَذِنْتُ لَكِ نَسْأَنُ. Now, Imam Hassan is there. Imam Hussein is there. Now, Imam Ali is there. Now, who else? Zahra said, فَدَنَوْتُ. Then I became closer to the blanket.
السَّلَامُ عَلَيْكَ يَا رَسُولَ.
Peace be upon you, Ya Rasulullah. أَتَأَذَنُ لِي. When he said, As-salamu alayka Ya Rasulullah, then the Prophet responded to Zahra. Now listen to the word the Prophet said to Zahra. وَعَلَيْكَ السَّلَامُ وَعَلَيْكِ السَّلَامُ يَا بِنْتِي وَيَا بَضَعَتِي. Allahu Akbar. See, brothers, Allah, there's no time to go in word by word on this word. بَضَعَ. بَضَعَ, what does it mean? See, in Arabic, there is part, right, part of something that if the part is there or not, it might not make big difference, right? For example, when you say, for example, juzo in Arabic means part, but part that even if it's not there, you can survive. For example, like a car. If a car misses a mirror, you still can drive, right? But if your car misses a tire, can you drive it? No. Now, a mirror is called juz', and tire is called baba. Now, in Arabic, when the Prophet didn't say, and like a juz', you are part of this, and ya baba'ati, meaning what? You are a part of me that I cannot function without you. That is the meaning of baba'a. But I mean, a part of me, that's what in some of the hadith, the Prophet says, Ruhi, alladhi bayna janbayn. Nafsi, just my soul, just my spirit, that I cannot function without. And that is the wording that the Prophet used, Bada'ati, the part of me that I cannot function without. Then she asked, Ata'adhan, would you please allow me to come under the blanket? Then the Prophet said, Kad adhintu lak. Allow her to give in. Zahra, she continued, she says, فَلَمَّا اكْتَمَلْنَا جَمِيعًا. After all of us, under the blanket, I said, أَوْ مَأَ أَبِي بِيَدِهِ الْيُمْنَى. The Prophet put his hand out of the blanket and raises towards the sky. فَقَال. Now he's speaking to Allah. The Prophet, under the blanket, now speaking to Allah. What did he say? I said, اللهم هؤلاء أهل بيتي وخاصتي وحامتي لحمهم لحمي ودمهم دمي
يؤلمني ما يؤلمهم ويحزنني ما يحزنهم.
أنا سلم لمن سالمهم وحرب لمن أحق لمن حاربهم وعدو لمن أعداء. الله أكبر.
No, the prophet is talking to Allah. Say, Ya Allah, هؤلاء, these people under the blanket, أهل بيتي, they are my family.
وخاصتي, and they are special to me. وحمتي, and they are my protectors.
لحمهم, their flesh is mine. ودمهم, the blood that runs in their body, is my blood. يؤلمني, anything that hurts them, hurts me.
Now here, let me pause here, and we're going to ask Rasulullah a question.
Ya Rasulullah, you say, يؤلمني, anything that hurts them, hurts me. Can we see the face of the Prophet when Zahra was hurt?
Hmm? Ya Rasulullah,
on that day when the house of Zahra was attacked, I want to see your face.
How did you feel? Yeah, you're telling us. I said, يؤلمني, anything that hurts them hurts me. Zahra was hurt.
Ya Rasulullah, how was your face on that day? When Zahra was crying for help.
When Zahra had a broken back and lost a baby. Ya Rasulullah, wow. She was in pain. I want to see how painful you were, Ya Rasulullah.
You are telling us, يؤلمني ما يؤلمهم. وَيَحْزُنُنِي مَا يَحْزُنُهُمْ. Anything that makes them sad, makes me sad. أَنَا حَرْبٌ لِمَنْ حَرْبٌ.
I am at war with any person who urges war at them.
وَسِلْمٌ. And I'm at peace with anybody who is at peace with them. فَجَأَلْ. Now the Prophet tells us his relationship with them.
Now he wants to make dua for them. فجعل سلواتك وبركاتك وغفرانك ورضوانك علي وعليهم وأذهب عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا.
Then
he made seven duas. Now understand the importance of seven duas of the Prophet on that night.
Now after the dua,
Allah then look at the angels in the heavens and he said, Ya malaikati wa ya sukana samawati inni ma khalaqtu sama'an mabniyan wala ardan madhiyan wala bahran yajri wala fulkan yasri wala illa limahabbati haula khamsati
tahtan. Now Allah is telling the angels and everyone who ever settled or lives in the heavens on the earth, he said, listen, I have not created anything that is the most beloved to me like those five individuals.
SubhanAllah. Allah sent the angels.
And then Allah, after he spoke to them, the angels, and then Jibreel, listen, was hearing, and he said, Ya Rabbi, wa man hum tahta.
Now look at the merits and the value of Zahra. Now, Jibreel cannot see who are the under the blanket because they were covered. He was asking Allah, Zahra alayhi salam, she covered the Prophet, but still can see the nur of the Prophet through that blanket.
But Jibreel, with all that value,
he couldn't see. He was asking Allah, who are those under the blanket? I can't see them.
Then Allah tells him, Hum, Ahlu Baytul Nubuwwah, wa Ma'dil Risalah. ومختلف الملائكة. Those are the families.
Those are the body and the pieces of the Prophet.
Then Jibreel asked Allah, أتأذنني? Would you give me permission so I can go down to be the sixth one of them? Then Allah told him yes.
But Ya Jibreel, before you go, I have a message for you. To them. What is the message? I said, go and tell them.
إنما يريد الله ليذهب عنكم الرجس ويطهركم
تطهيرا.
Jibreel comes down. Right? But here one important thing. Allah.
Jibreel, when he asked Allah, who are those under the blanket? Now listen to the how Allah wants to introduce those Ashabul Kisa. Under the blanket, there is the Prophet, there is Zahra, there is Ali, there is Hassan, there is Hussein. But when Allah wanted to introduce them, He said, Ahum Fatima. Allahu Akbar. The first one out of all, Allah mentioned Zahra first, thumma abuha wa ba'luha wa banuha. Allah started with Zahra first, and then Rasul, and then the Imam Ali, and then Hassan al-Hussein. Allahu Akbar. You know why? Why Zahra first? Why not Rasulullah? Ya Allah! Because Allah wants to tell us Zahra, she is the bridge between the Risalat and the Imam. She's the bridge. Because Rasulullah is the end of the Risala, and the Imam has to start after the Prophet. Now they have to merge somewhere where the Imamah comes to mix with the Risala, so the Imamah can take the big, can continue from there. And Zahra was the bridge to bring the two oceans together, Risala and Imamah, and mix them together so that the lineage of Imamah can start. That is Zahra. That is why when Allah mentioned, He said, Hum Fatima wa Abuha, what is the Prophet? Wa Ba'aluha, what is Imam Ali? Two oceans, Imamah and the Risala. Now they all came together, where? In Zahra, and give the production of Hassan and Hussein. And that is the message that Allah was telling Jibreel. Hum Fatima wa Rasulullah, and then Ali, and then Hassan. That is just the brief that Allah wanted. All of this happened where? In the house of Zahra, Alayhi. And at the end, what the Prophet wants to emphasize is the importance of time. But what happened after this incident? After this incident, you go to also all the tafasir. They mentioned that 6 months after this ayah was revealed, the Prophet will come and knock the house of Zahra and say, Assalamu alaykum ya ahla bayt al-Nabi. For 6 months. Every morning the Prophet will call them in this. But after the soon after the Prophet died, the entire Muslims, they turned away from that. The house where Jibreel asked permission, they entered the house against the will of Allah. The house where Zahra alayhi salam lives in, where Allah told the Prophet to ask permission before he enters, and Hassan and Hussein, they enter as permission before they enter. Imam Ali asked permission before. That house was invaded and was set up on fire too. Not just they attacked the house and that was it. No, there was invasion. They set up the house on fire. And Zahra was in there. And Zahra was calling her father. Ya Rasulullah, when did you die and when are we facing these tragedies? The first thing they did to Zahra alayhi salam was to take the land that the Prophet gave to her son Fadik. The Prophet gave to her. Soon after the Prophet died, they seized that Fadik. Zahra went to the masjid and he said, why are you taking my inheritance? My father gave it to me. It's my gift from my father. Even if it's not a gift, after my father dies, I have the right to inherit. And you know what she was told? The answer came. Ya Zahra, we heard the hadith of the Prophet says, we the Prophet, whatever when we die, whatever we live becomes sadaqah. We cannot be inherited. Zahra alayhi salam, she quoted an ayah from the Quran. It says, وَوَرِثَ سُلَيْمَانَ دَاوُودَ. Dawood, when he died, his son Suleiman inherited him. And Quran said, وَوَرِثَ. He inherited everything the father left. If Dawood alayhi salam would inherit, and Dawood dies and his son inherit, why can't I inherit my father? And she gave one thick rule also in that khutbah. He said, أَوَلَيْسَ أَنَا وَأَبِي عَلَى مِلَّةٍ وَاحِدًا. Because in Islam, if a father dies and the child It's not on the same religion with the father. That the father is a Muslim, the child, the son is not a Muslim, there is no inheritance between them. And Zahra was making that rule. She said, "Awalastu ana wa abi ala millatin wahid." We, me and my father, on the same religion, that you are allowed to inherit your father, and I'm not allowed to inherit my father. They took that inheritance from him. They took the imamat from Imam Ali alayhi salam. Then that is not imam. Now they have to attack the house of Saqqa. Now the narration said that the night of the Shahada of Zahra alayhi salam, she called her husband, Imam Ali alayhi salam. He said, "Ya Ali, indi wasai, I have will that I want you to fulfill after I pass." Imam Ali alayhi salam was listening to Zahra alayhi salam. "What is your will? What do you want?" He said, "Ya Ali, my wish is number one. Nobody should see my body after I pass, except you and my family." "Yes. I do not permit anybody to walk behind my coffin." Imam Ali said, "That will do." What else, Ya Zahra? She said, "Ya Ali, I want you to make sure that my grave is hidden. Nobody knows it. Because I have a point, I have a message that I want people to know that I left this world angrily about those people who killed me." Imam Ali said, "That, Ya Zahra. What else?" "Ya Ali," I said, "I want you every night to come to my grave and read me two surahs from the Quran." "What is it?" "Surah Yasin and Safat. Please, I love these surahs and I read them a lot. After I pass, come to my grave and read them to me." And you know, Imam Ali used to go there after Hajj. He will go there to read these two surahs for the Zahra. Until one day Imam Ali went, as he was read and finished and he was there, then he fell a little asleep for a few seconds. And he saw Zahra in his dream. And Zahra was crying. He asked her, "Ya Zahra, mimma buka'ak?" "I read the surah that you asked me." Then Zahra said, "Ya Ali, I'm not crying for the surahs. But I want to tell you that you don't have to come to my grave from today, from tonight. I lifted the responsibility. Don't come." Imam Ali asked, "Why?" She said, "I saw Hussein has woken up. Hey, look around. I was not there. You were not there. And I saw Hussein was looking left and right, looking for me and you, and we both are not there." And I don't want to break their heart to that extent. "So from tonight, Ya Ali, stay home with the Hassan and Hussein." Allahu Akbar. Then he said to him, "Ya Ali," she said to him, "Ya Ali, and also I want you to find someone who can take care of these children, Al Hassan and Hussein, because they're so dear to me. Please find a lady who will be at least closer to me and give them the love and care." Allahu Akbar. That is part of her will. Imam Ali alayhi salam said, "Ya Zahra, everything that you ask will be done exactly like that." Imam Ali alayhi salam comes towards the body of Zahra alayhi salam. Asma Akul, she said, "I was there. Wallahi, I saw the body of Zahra. Every time we want to wash a side," he said, "the side itself moves for us to wash it." Allahu Akbar. I said, "Until a time that I saw Ali busted into tears, I asked, Ya Ali, mimma buka'uk, why you crying?" Imam Ali said, "Wallahi, I saw the broken rib. My heart has touched where the broken rib is. And that is what brought me to these tears." Zahra alayhi salam, she didn't die like natural cause. She was killed. She was broken. She had a broken bone. And she lost her child as well. Imam Ali alayhi salam, the night of burial, when he took her to the grave, when he put her in the grave, he remembered one wasiyya, one will from the Prophet. Because the night of the Prophet death, he asked Imam Ali to come closer. Imam Ali came. He took the hand of Zahra and put in the hand of Ali. And he said, "Ya Ali, hadhihi wadi'ati indak. This is my trust that I want you to take good care of." So the night of burial, Imam Ali, after he put in the grave, he called, he said, "Ya Rasulallah, hadhihi wadi'atun ruddat ilayk. This is your trust that you give me. Now I'm returning it to you back, Ya Rasulallah." But there is one thing, Ya Ali, you brought that trust, and it is not broken, not the way Rasulullah gave it to you. Those people have killed Zahra alayhi salam. Those enemies of Allah, they broke her rib, they made her angry, they left her, and she was only 18 years old. Imagine, Allahu Akbar. Imam Ali alayhi salam was taking Zahra to the grave, and Hassan and Hussein, they were following, crying, Aina Ummuna Zahra, where is Umad Zahra alayhi salam? That is how they left Imam Hassan and Hussein, and the pain for the rest of their lives. Inna lillah wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Wa sayalamu alladhina zalamu ayya muntalabin yantalibun. Ya Allah, we ask you for the sake of the night of the burial of Zahra alayhi salam. Ya Allah, we ask you, our brothers and sisters who are sick, for the sickness of Zahra, Ya Allah, give them all of them the shafa'a, Ya Rabb al-Alamin. Our marhumin, brothers and sisters, Ya Allah, you know them better than us. Those who are in your rahmah, Ya Allah, increase your rahmah upon them, Ya Rabbal Alamin. Those might be in your punishment, you know them better than us, Ya Allah. Have your mercy of them, Ya Allah, Ya Rabbal Alamin. Ya Allah, Yawm al-Qiyamah, grant us the shafa' of Zahra, alayhi salam, Ya Rabbal Alamin. Ila amwat al-mu'minin wal-mu'minat, ila siyam al-jalisin al-hadirin, رحم الله من يقرأ الفاتحة مع الصلوات.
اللهم صل على محمد.